Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Welcome to this service of worship at Central Saanich United Church on this fifth Sunday of Easter. I, Bob Gilbert, along with Amy Newell, Helen Wright, Nancy Jacobson, and Bill Cole, bring you greetings. I invite you to have some bread and juice available to celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion later in the service. I commend to you the readings. There's quite a few announcements today in the service bulletin, which you should have been able to download from our church website. One of those announcements has to do with the United Church's Mission and Service Fund. This fund is a vital way the United Church provides outreach to others in Canada and around the world in partnership with secular and faith groups in the area in which the need is found. This year for Mother's Day, which is just next Sunday, the United Church Philanthropy Unit is offering an opportunity to support mission and service partners at home and abroad in honor of mothers, supporting things like prenatal and parenting classes, respite care, medical clinics, safe shelters, and education for children. In return, as a donor, you would receive access to special e-cards for Mother's Day that you can send out. Here is a short video about the program.
Mom, you support me in so many ways. I can't think of a better way to honor you than to make a difference for others. Mother's Day can be more meaningful, can be more sensitive, can be more inclusive. It can be more compassionate. It can be more generous. Mother's Day can be more. And that's why when you make a special gift through Mission and Service this Mother's Day, you will directly support families in need in Canada and around the world. You will help provide things like parenting classes, respite care, health clinics, safe shelter, and education to families who need it. And when you make a gift, you can choose to send any one of a variety of free e-cards that I guarantee you won't find on the shelves of your local card shop. Give a gift to help families and let someone in your life know they are your inspiration. Together, we can make Mother's Day more.
Please also take note of the annual UCW plant sale, which Helen spoke about last week, and there's information again in the bulletin for you. And finally, as we gear up for the Pride Sunday worship service on June 27th with special guests and celebrations on this faith community becoming an affirming congregation, you will note the opportunity to purchase a lovely Affirm United t-shirt. Marion Garnett has kindly offered to place these orders for you, and you will note the contact information in the bulletin announcement. I put in my order. And you will also note that there is a pride flag now permanently in place at the front of the church hall. This signals to passersby that our church is safe, hospitable, inclusive of everyone, including LGBTQ+ persons. As we continue our service, please know that whoever you are, wherever you are as you view this recording, whenever you might view this recording, God's Spirit is with you in this act of worship. Know that you are a valued part of this community of God's people. Physical distancing and separation do not detract from the reality of our spiritual connectedness with Christ and through Christ with one another. The images we find in our Bible to reveal the fullness of Jesus' grace are many and varied. Certainly one that we hear often is Jesus as the light of the world. Today, we will explore the image of Jesus that is familiar to many of you who are gardeners: vine and branch, sun and soil, fruit and pruning. We light this candle, acknowledging Jesus, the true vine.
And our opening hymn today is found at Voices United number 256, O God Beyond All Praising.
Jesus said, I am the vine and you are the branches. Abide in me as I abide in you.
As we worship today in word and song and prayer, we do so not as separate individuals, but as a community held together by our common bond in Christ.
May we be branches that bear much fruit for the well-being of one another and for the world. Let us pray. God of love, plant us in the soil of your grace.
Nurture us with the strength of Christ, the vine of abundant life.
Enlighten us with the wisdom of your Spirit, which flows through us today and all days.
Abide in us, that we may abide in you and live in your love.
In your holy name we pray.
Amen. And our next hymn, Like the Murmur of the Dove's Song, text found at Voices United 205, this is an original melody.
Jesus said, "Abide in me as I abide in you." Let us take a moment of quiet to bask in the abiding of Christ among us and within us.
And today we welcome Nancy Jacobson and Bill Cole to read the scripture for us.
Let us pray. Illuminating Spirit, you sent your Son into the world that we might live through him. May we abide in his risen life, guided by your word, so that we may bear the fruit of love for one another and know the fullness of joy. Amen.
Amen.
The scripture reading for today is part of the farewell discourses of Jesus and contains the last of the I am statements. Here you have the image of the vine, an agricultural metaphor describing the interrelatedness of God, Jesus, and his disciples. Reading from the Gospel according to John chapter 15, verses 1 to 8. Jesus said, "I am the true vine, and God is the gardener. God cuts off every branch that doesn't produce fruit, and God prunes the branches that do bear fruit so they will produce even more. You have already been pruned for greater fruitfulness by the message I have given you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish and it will be done for you. God is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples."
And now, a reading from The World Around Us, a poem by Victoria Safford entitled, "Did the Sun Come Up This Morning?" which proclaims the new life that both spring and Easter bring to the world. "The dead shall rise again. Have you seen the trees? Have you seen the maple buds? The magnolias, swelling, poplars, the first lacy pale spray across the shoulder of the hills. Forsythia, or as one child I know calls it, the three Scythia, the two Scythia, and those three small flowering perfect crab apple trees in the park stroll along little trees begging children to climb them and get lost for a while in their magical pink canopies. Did you smell the rain this week? And the muddy, ready earth receiving it? Did you smell the musty, lusty, moldy pine of leaves all thawed now, and underneath the moist and living earthworms wide awake? Is it safe, I wonder, to presume that we have all seen the dead resurrected? Can we presume just quietly among us this basic fact? Can we admit, however carefully at first, however foolish it may sound, that once or twice in our lives, or perhaps over and over and tumbling over, we have seen events miraculous? Choose the words you will, whatever words you need. If miracle cloys, try unexpected, surprising, unanticipated, lucky. That which has given us that second chance, that second wind, by the grace of God knows what, the dead shall rise again. We know because we've seen it. Did the sun come up this morning? No thanks to us and all for us. Did the earth awake again or did it not? We will testify to resurrection. Here end the readings from Scripture and from the world around us. For those words and insights, we give God thanks and praise.
Thank you, Nancy and Bill. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. In biblical times, the vine was an emblem of Israel, like the maple leaf is an emblem of Canada. And Jesus spoke of himself as the vine, his followers as the branches. He described the life of faith as relational, about being in right relationship with God and with one another, as it were, organically, like a vine and its branches. Too often in religious circles, the emphasis is not relational, but legalistic, focused on proper laws, rules, regulations, doctrines. And often these are beneficial, but they also can be counterproductive and even harmful. Jesus taught that laws and rules are good only to the extent that they foster healthy, loving relationships. Without this understanding, laws and rules can bring bitterness and attitudes of self-righteousness and exclusiveness. To counter such an emphasis, Jesus spoke of himself as the vine, his followers as the branches. Our lives become productive, that is, they bear fruit, as we rightly relate to him. And those who rightly relate to him rightly relate to others. The life of faith is more about relationship than about rules. Now, in order for the vine to bear appropriate fruit that will nourish and strengthen right relationships, there must be adequate preparation. One of Aesop's fables tells of one such preparation. The fable features a dying farmer who gathered his children around him to impart to them a secret of much worth. He said to them, "My children, I am shortly to die. I would have you know, therefore, that in my vineyard there lies a hidden treasure. Dig, and you will find it." As soon as their father was dead, the children took to shoveling up the soil of the vineyard over and over again in the search for the treasure, which they supposed was buried there. In the end, they found none. However, the vines, after so much thorough digging, produced a crop such as had never been seen before. One must till the soil as part of proper preparation. Jesus, in his metaphor, names God as the gardener who tills the soil, not to find treasure, but to ensure we are planted in the midst of God's boundless grace. A second preparation to ensure fruit bearing is pruning. Jesus says God cuts off every barren branch. Even those branches that do bear fruit, God prunes so they will be even more fruitful. I don't know about you, but I don't like the idea of being pruned. Having something removed from me, cut away, sounds rather painful. But the book of Hebrews notes, no discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace. Yes, it is painful, God's pruning of us. but it's also a gift of grace. Reverend Jeff Cook writes of this, "I do not know much about gardening," he says, "but I do know something about being pruned. I have experienced God pruning me of beliefs and prejudices and attitudes. God has had to prune away my certainties that only heterosexuals are children of God, and my judgments about who is in and who is out of favor with God. God is still pruning away attitudes that limit my awareness of the breadth and the depth of God's love. I am glad that God is a good gardener. God's pruning is a gift of grace." As with all of life, much depends on how we look at it. What is our perspective? Dr. Stephen Covey, in his book, 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, tells of riding a subway one weekend morning. It was peaceful and quiet. Then at one stop, a man with a large family of children got on. The man sat down next to Dr. Covey. At once, pandemonium broke loose. The children were running up and down the aisles, making lots of noise, bumping into people, throwing things at one another, disturbing the passengers, even grabbing their newspapers. The father sat down, saying nothing, doing nothing. At last, Covey decided to say something to the father. The man's head was down, was just sort of staring, and Covey nudged him and asked, "Sir, don't you think maybe it'd be wise for you to say something to your children? Settle them down? The passengers are getting very annoyed." The father lifted his head and in a fog said, "Oh, I suppose so. I just didn't notice. We just left the hospital. Their mother died an hour ago. I don't know what to do, how to respond, and I suppose they don't know how to react either." "Oh," said Covey, "I am so sorry. Is there anything I can do to help?" Covey's mood went from annoyance to empathy. A lot depends on our perceptions. We often don't see the whole picture. Sometimes it hurts, but God yearns to prune our perceptions, our attitudes, our knee-jerk reactions, so that we might be more understanding, less judgmental, more open to seeing a broader picture. God prunes us so that we might bear fruit, the fruit of Christ-like living, of Christ-like action. Jesus says, "Abide in me as I abide in you. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish and it will be done for you." That's a problematic verse. That verse, misunderstood, has caused a lot of grief. Certainly, I have asked God for things wished for, as I'm sure you have as well, and a lot of those prayers didn't get answered as we had hoped. But the intent of Jesus' comment is not meant to refer so much to our own personal wants and desires, though God is concerned about those matters as well. In these words of Jesus, it's all about the abiding, us in Jesus and Jesus in us, such that the branches are so infused with the life of the vine that what we wish and what we ask is part and parcel of the vine. When we remain close to Jesus, we attune to him and he to us. The remarkable result is that we want, what we want is what God wants, all at the same time. Jesus is referring here to asking that God's good purposes, which are then also ours, come to fruition. "If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish and it will be done for you." All that is extraneous is carefully and lovingly removed. What remains is centered and focused in God's word. The vine feeds its life into the branches. Jesus feeds his life, God's will, into our lives. Our will, like Jesus' will, is to do the will of God. That is the asking of which Jesus is speaking in this passage of Scripture, to be enabled to do the will of God in our lives. The context of Jesus' speech to his disciples is shortly before his death. He has gathered his disciples around him and seeks to prepare them for his departure. Jesus foresees the hardships and death he is about to endure. And he meets with his followers one last time. As he does so, he yearns to console them. He knows the trials they will face in the days ahead. Jesus invites his disciples to enter into a closer relationship by urging them to abide in him. Rather than sounding a note of despair, Jesus speaks a word of hope and trust for their souls. Reassurance comes from the remaining close to Jesus, weathering whatever storms may come. Jesus tells his disciples to abide in him as he abides in them. I like Eugene Peterson's Message translation, which says, "Live in me, make your home in me, just as I do in you." The idea of making a home, of finding the heart's true home in Jesus, often produces within us a settled peace, even in the midst of turmoil that often characterizes our lives. When someone's having a difficult time, we may casually give the advice to hang in there. Those are not very helpful words for one who desperately wonders how to do just that. Jesus offers so much more than hanging in there. No doubt hard times do arise for all of us. But living, abiding, finding our home in Jesus the vine and God the grower has the capacity to sustain us, strengthen us, nourish us. Recall the Hebrew notion of shalom. Shalom speaks of wholeness, completeness, and well-being. Recovering that sense of shalom addresses the deep yearnings of our lives. For shalom enters into all the pain and hurts we endure each day. It enables us to speak of healing, even when there is no hope for a cure. I'm reminded of this powerful abiding in Christ and Christ abiding in us whenever I receive a prayer request to be shared with the faith community, or when at the side of a hospital bed, prayer is shared. For certain, absolutely for certain, healing does take place. Maybe not in the body, at least not right away, but often in the mind, in the soul, in the emotional life, which in turn can be most beneficial to physical healing. That connection of branches to the vine suggests the image of life-giving sap flowing from the vine to the branches, which gives shalom, healing, in the midst of trouble and turmoil. Bearing fruit arises from our union with Jesus, finding that home in him, letting his word find a home in us through faithful devotion brings about a deep, profound joy. And joy is not a simple happiness. It is a sense of shalom, a profound understanding that as turbulent and troubled as life may be for us at times, our lives are anchored to the assurance that nothing can separate us from the love of God through Christ. As Jesus counsels and prays with his disciples, he invites them to stay close to him and place their trust in him. He warns them that they cannot go it alone, trusting to their own strength. On their own, they would be cut off from their life source. They would bear little fruit. Now, this is a word his followers should heed in this day and age. Temptation to do it all on our own is very great. We live in a society that promotes independence and individualism, making something of yourself. You've heard the slogans. Help yourself. Make yourself into something. Just love yourself, as if that were easy. Be the master of your own fate. Take control of your life. Get a life by yourself, for yourself. Though valid goals in some respects, it can become very easy to think that it's all up to us and our own resources as we try to solve problems and meet challenges. Jesus says something very different. We are not solitary branches. We are branches together. Christ, the vine, binds us together. And admittedly, it's not always so easy living or sharing community with other branches. Branches are not always so strong or reliable or healthy or sturdy. They can rub us the wrong way, even cut and scrape us. But that is life in the vine. We are not branches alone. I've heard some folks say, I can worship God all by myself. I don't need to be part of the church. I'm not so sure about that. I believe that God wants us to worship and to live our lives in community. Branches together, connected to one another through our connection to the vine, which is Christ. And the key to living with other branches is to remember the vine. It is Jesus, the vine, who binds us together and not we ourselves. And the branches are to bear fruit. The more the branches, that's us, abide in the vine, that's Jesus, the more we'll give, the more we'll share, the more we'll reach out with compassion, the more we'll seek to understand and to empathize, the more we will be Christ-like in our words and in our actions, in our relationships with one another. So, my friends, Jesus is the vine, and we are the branches. We are loving and beloved branches of God. We are gifted branches. We are beautiful branches. But, and this is actually good news, believe me, we are the branches. We are not the vine. Ultimately, it's not about the love, hope, and life we create for ourselves, but the love, hope, and life that Jesus the vine pours into us. Let us abide in him as he abides in us. And by this we will give God glory, bearing the fruit of Christ-like living in and for the world. Amen.
Today's hymn of response is found at Voices United, number 588. Many are the light beams.
Today, we are invited into a close attachment to our Savior, Jesus Christ, as branches are attached to the vine. Through that close connection, we are nurtured and strengthened to bear fruit with a spirit of love by helping each other, reaching out to each other, and encouraging each other in our daily walk of faith. As it is written in the book of Ecclesiastes, two are better than one, because if they fall, one will lift up the other. So let our offerings lift up one another in God's love. Let our offerings be a thanksgiving of God's love that we spread to others in fruitful actions. Let us offer ourselves as we are able in gratitude and with generosity, expressing the abiding goodness of God that grows within us and nurtures others through us.
I'll sing.
Let us pray. Creator God, take our gifts of money and labor and self that represent the fruits of our love for you, for our community, and for ourselves. Use these gifts as you use us to spread the message of love throughout the world. Amen. In prayer. Gracious God, we offer our prayers trusting in your listening love. We raise our hearts in thanksgiving and praise as we celebrate the warmth and renewed vitality of this season of spring. As we make our way along streets and byways, even in this time of pandemic, we see you everywhere. In children playing in the park, and folks sunning themselves on a bench, in the eyes of strangers and neighbors who seek something also in our eyes as we pass. As we celebrate this season of newness, touch us, O God, with your gentle caress. Hold us in your strong embrace. Breathe into us your recreative spirit. We thank you as well, O God, for the glorious message of this Easter season. Life out of death, hope out of despair, growth where all was dry and withered. Help us, God, to look for newness in our lives, to rekindle all that is lovely, all that is holy, all that is good. You are the vine of life. In your branches we are nestled, taking shelter and sustenance in the shade of your strength. With thanksgiving we celebrate the growth and hope we have found in placing our roots in you, for in life you nourish us and your Holy Spirit encourages us to reach our full potential in the gifts we have been given, that others may know of your love. Lord, make us more than sour grapes and unripe apples in the hardships of the world. May we look beyond the bitter politics and divisions to find your love at the core of our relationships. There may all people work with what we have in common, that we might grow to be a people of respect and trust. May our branches bow with the weight of the fruit you have bestowed. Help us to look beyond our own needs to recognize those who are hungry for food, love, and justice. May we offer others the shelter needed under the weight of your branches so they find a rest from the cold and darkness, the hatred and loneliness of this world. May our leaves soak up your light when we meet those who are worn down with illness, loneliness, grief, and abandonment. May the light of your presence shine within those encounters that all might know your compassion. Today we think especially of Dennis Hartley, ill in hospital. We pray for the light of your love to shine on him and on Marlene and her caring, loving concern for him. Gardener of all life, as you trim and shape us for your good purposes, may we place our prayers into your hands and trust that new seeds may grow from tired and empty thoughts. We pray all this through Jesus Christ, who taught us this prayer we now say aloud and together. Our Father, our Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And our next hymn at Voices United 468, Let Us Talents and Tongues Employ. True vine, I invite you to drink. In the name of the one who said, love one another as I have loved you, I invite you to this table of Jesus Christ. This is an open table. All are welcome. Share in this simple yet profound meal, not because you have to, but because you may. Receive each and every one of you the deep and abiding blessing that this sacrament offers. May the Lord of Easter be with you.
And also with you.
Open your hearts to God.
We lift them to the one who fills our lives with joy and wonder.
Children of Easter, give praise to God.
Our voices unite in thanksgiving to the one who walks with us on this journey of life.
You opened your hands, pouring creation's glory into the emptiness of chaos, God of beginnings. The sun, moon, and stars became the mirrors of the light of your face, shining down upon all that was crafted. Shaping us in your divine image, you stood beside us, pointing out all the good you offer to us. But we found comfort in sin's shadows, fear and doubt claiming us as friends, and we turned our backs on you. Through our ancestors in the faith, such as Sarah and Samuel, Hannah and Hosea, you demonstrated your faithfulness, your longing to welcome us into your embracing arms of love. But we did not recognize them and clung to the vain words spoken to us by temptation. So you sent your child to us to show us what love truly is, that we might have this hope offered to us in Jesus. So with little children who delight in your joy, and with older folks who trust in your promises, with our siblings throughout all time, we join our voices in praising your name.
Holy, 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 God of grace and beauty, all creation joins in singing your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes obeying by him. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed are you, holy and righteous God, and blessed is Jesus Christ, author of life. In the Word become flesh, you call us to repent and turn to you. In the light of the world, our eyes are opened so we can see you standing with us. In scarred hands and feet, we see the power of sin and death destroyed by your grace and hope, so we can reach out and embrace that life which is ours forever with you. As we gather around the table to remember, as we give thanks for the life which was given for us, we speak of what we do not always understand, the mystery of faith.
Christ walked to Calvary to die for us. Christ strode from the tomb to raise us to life. Christ will come and stand among us to lead us home.
We remember that when Jesus ate with his friends, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Each time you do this, remember me." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, passed it to his friends, saying, "Drink. This cup that is poured out for you is the promise of God made in my blood. Whenever you drink it, remember me." In this moment and in this place, pour out your spirit upon us and on the gifts of bread and cup which have been prepared for us. As we take the bread from scarred hands, may we reach out to mend the broken of our world. As we drink from the cup, open our hearts and eyes so we may see those the world overlooks, so we may stand with them in every moment and every place. And when our journey has ended, when at last all is revealed to us, we will take our places at the great banquet in heaven, everyone included at the table, no one a stranger, no one alone, no one unloved, all proclaiming thanks and joy to you, God in community, God of love, now and forevermore.
Amen. Amen.
And our last hymn for today. Oh, I'm sorry.
Jesus Christ, the bread of life. And Jesus Christ, the true vine. Gifts of God for the people of God, let us now share this meal, eating this meal, sharing the goodness of our Lord. Let us pray. God of all fruitfulness, we thank you for giving us the true vine, Jesus Christ. We know that Christ abides in us by the Spirit given to us. Separated from Christ, we can do nothing. Enable us to love one another as Christ has loved us, just as Christ has commanded us. We ask this in the name of our Savior. Go forth to bear the fruit of justice, service, and love to the world.
We go abiding in Christ, whose words abide in us.
Receive the blessing of God, the gardener, Christ, the vine, and the Holy Spirit, the comforter, this day and every day.
Amen.
And now our last hymn, found at Voices United, number 420. Go to the world.
Christ will make. Hallelujah. Christmas.